On June 13th, 2017, a warm, quiet night in the North Kensington area of West London looked far from turning into a chaotic one. Residents of the lower-income Lancaster West Housing Estate were sound asleep. In one flat on the fourth floor, a strange smell from his kitchen woke up a tenant. When he went to check it, he saw smoke coming from the back of his refrigerator. The fire quickly spread across the poor man's kitchen, who immediately raised the alarm and called the firefighters. The fire seemed like a challenge London firefighters were facing every day. However, once the fire went out of the kitchen window, it turned into a blaze that not even 250 firefighters could extinguish for the next 24 hours. But how can a thing like a refrigerator burn down a 24-story tower? Grenfell Tower. Today, North Kensington is considered an exclusive area of the City of London, one with super high real estate prices. However, North Kensington was not always a posh neighborhood. In the 1960s, the area was inhabited mainly by a working class population and immigrants. Even today, there are residues of these old times, islands of council housing estates surrounded by upmarket residences. One such is Lancaster West Estate. In the late 1960s, the Royal Borough of Kensington and Chelsea started a project to eliminate the slums in North Kensington and replace them with a modern council housing estate. The project, imagined as ideal for living, was devised in 1972. Phase 1 of the plan consisted of a 24-story tower with three lower finger blocks and a landscaped green area between them. When it was completed in 1974, it was a big step forward for social housing standards. The estate and the entire area was dominated by a 24-story building, the Grenfell Tower. Designed by Clifford Wearden and Associates in a brutalist style, quite popular among architects at the time, they projected the building to have 120 flats with 200 bedrooms. Each of the 20 residential floors had 6 apartments, 2 more than the standard at the time. Grenfell Tower was an innovative building for many other things. Like most towers, Grenfell also had a concrete structure. However, unlike other constructions, Grenfell Tower designers refrained from using brick walls for infill. Instead, they used prefabricated insulated concrete panels. The aim was to make the entire structure as solid as possible and avoid any possibility of a collapse, as has happened 6 years earlier when an entire corner of the Ronan Point Tower collapsed. When finished, Grenfell Tower constructors claimed that the building would last for another 100 years. For the next 40 years, the Grenfell Tower went from the area's landmark to an old and ugly pile of concrete. Brutalism was largely outmoded in the 2010s, and the building needed to be refreshed. However, it was because of the lack of proper insulation that the local council decided to invest in the building's reconstruction. Grenfell Tower got a fresh look in 2013. Flats had a water-based heating system installed, and old windows were replaced with new, more energy-efficient ones. For the same reason, the concrete facade was covered with insulation foam and aluminum rainscreen cladding. Not only did the cladding improve the efficiency of energy consumption, but it gave the building a modern, more appealing look. It seemed like the council did an outstanding job with the renovation. As living conditions improved, the entire estate became more alluring. Not everyone, however, was satisfied with how the council was taking care of the building. Some tenants accused the council of failing to observe several safety issues, primarily those regarding fire safety installations. The building, they said, was highly vulnerable to fire. It was as if they foresaw the events of June 17, 2017. The fire. The operator of the London Fire Brigade received a call that day at 54 minutes after midnight. Behelu Kabede, a tenant from flat number 16 on the fourth floor, called the firefighters reporting the fire in his kitchen. 5 minutes later, 4 fire engines arrived at the scene. The firefighters who entered the flat located the source of the fire 7 minutes after they entered. By that time, the fire from the kitchen had spread through the window and into the rain screen cladding. To everyone's surprise, the fire quickly spread upwards and across the building's eastern side, where the kitchen window was positioned. In less than 30 minutes, the fire reached the top floor of the tower. The flames reached the northern side at 1:42 a.m. and continued to spread along the facade, both upwards and to the side. 10 minutes later, the fire reached the southern side of the building. The entire building was about to be caught on fire. As they approached Grenfell Tower, London firefighters noticed a glimmering light on the fourth floor. Nothing special, one of them noted. A little more than an hour later, at 2:06 a.m., they declared the fire a major incident. Still, the firefighters advised tenants not to leave their apartments. The Grenfell Tower had a stay-put policy in case of fire. As strange as it sounds, the policy was a standard procedure in all buildings similar to Grenfell Tower. In case of fire in one apartment, the construction of the building, namely its thick concrete walls, would provide security for tenants in other apartments. The fire could last for hours in the apartment. The concrete walls and doors made of fire-resistant material would keep it confined and prevent it from spreading. Unfortunately, the firefighters failed to foresee that the fire would spread along the building facade and reach other apartments from outside. Once they realized that the fire was taking the entire building, the firefighters abandoned the stay-put policy and advised tenants to evacuate. For many, it was too late. Escaping the inferno. It was a lucky occasion that most tenants trusted their instincts rather than follow procedures. By 2:47 a.m., when the decision was made to give up on the stay-put procedure, more than half of around 300 tenants had already evacuated the building. However, 100 or so remained inside. Instead of evacuating, many ran upstairs, seeking refuge from their friends on the top floors. The only thing they did was to find themselves cut off. At 3 a.m., as the fire spread across the building's western side, it became practically impossible for tenants trapped inside to leave the building. More than half of the 120 flats caught on fire. Elevators were out of use, and the only staircase in the tower was filled with toxic smoke. Nevertheless, the brave men of the London Fire Brigade were rushing in and out, saving everyone within their reach. The most challenging aspect of the task was locating the tenants trapped inside. Many of them used their phones to contact the fire brigade center, revealing their position. The dispatcher then contacted the officer in charge at the site, who passed the message to the men inside the tower. Because of the noise, it was impossible to use radio communication. Instead, a messenger passed the command's orders on a piece of paper. In every disaster, fear is a man's greatest enemy. Caught in panic, tenants moved from one apartment to another. There were cases when firefighters came into the flat from which they received the call for rescue and found no one inside. Some tenants chose not to wait for the rescue, but tried themselves to find alternate routes for rescue. There were some curious attempts to leave the building, such as one tenant who attempted to climb down from his flat using tied bedsheets. Some bystanders even reported people jumping out of their windows in an attempt to save themselves from fire. At 4:30 a.m., the whole building was engulfed with fire. The high temperature inside prevented the firefighters from searching the building for trapped tenants. By that time, they had rescued only 36 of them after the stay-put policy was abandoned. 70 of their neighbors never left the building. Most of them died on the top floors. They tried to escape the fire, believing firefighters would extinguish the fire before it reached the very top of the building. Little did they know. In a matter of minutes, the fire somehow reached the top floors to the surprise of everyone present. Indeed, how did it happen so fast? That was a key question in the investigation that followed. Causes. The last tenant to be rescued from the building was taken out at 8:07 a.m. The fire was brought under control only at 1:14 a.m. the following day. It was more than 24 hours after the fire brigade received the call. They extinguished the last pockets of fire on the evening of June 16th. The investigation undoubtedly determined that the refrigerator in flat number 16 was the source of the fire. The faulty refrigerator, that is. Its compressor relay wiring was not fitted properly and therefore caused the overheating and setting of plastic insulation on the back of the fridge on fire. The reasons why the entire building went into flames in just 3 hours were entirely different, though. The investigation showed that the main factor to be blamed for the tragedy was the cladding. When the building was renovated in 2013, cladding installation was the most demanding and most expensive part. The original concrete facade of the building was covered with 150 millimeter thick polyisocyanurate insulation foam plates. Over the installation, rain screen aluminum sandwich panels with polyethylene cores were fitted. Between the insulation and the aluminum panels, there was a 50 millimeter ventilation gap. All these features proved to be problematic and a crucial reason why the fire spread so quickly. Polyisocyanurate insulation is made of extremely flammable material. When ignited, it burns rapidly and releases toxic gases. When used in tall buildings such as Grenfell Tower, the manufacturer-provided guide recommended the insulation be used in combination with special non-combustible rain screen panels and vertical and horizontal fire breaks to meet fire safety standards. The aluminum rain screen panels fitted to Grenfell Tower were also anything but non-combustible. The aluminum plates were, but the panel core made of polyethylene was not. What's more, the material is highly flammable. These panels were not recommended for use on buildings taller than 10 meters. When Grenfell Tower caught on fire, aluminum rainscreen cladding burned like a match. The last part of the deadly combination was a gap between the rainscreen panels and the insulation foam. Without properly installed fire breaks, it caused a chimney effect, pushing the fire to upper floors in no time. The question was, how did the local council fail to observe all these deficiencies? As always, it was all about the money. When the reconstruction started, the council was guided by the cost rather than quality. Better contractors and more appropriate cladding were refused only due to cost. What the council showed was the ultimate level of neglect toward the safety of Grenfell Tower tenants. Even when tenants complained about cladding and other fire safety irregularities, the council threatened them with legal action for defamation. Aftermath. The result was the Grenfell Tower fire, the worst residential fire disaster in the United Kingdom since World War II. 72 tenants lost their lives in the fire, the youngest being only 6 months old. The lucky 223 escaped the building before it was too late, but not without consequences. Both tenants and firefighters on duty were exposed to highly toxic gases that caused them health problems at later stages. Their mental health was also damaged, with many suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. The final damage of the fire that includes various expenses from death and injury compensation to rebuilding costs rose to an incredible £1 billion. It will never be enough, though, to make up for losing innocent lives. Lives that could have been saved if only everyone were doing their job properly. Thank you for watching our video. If you like it, please remember to hit the like button. If you want to see more of us, go ahead and subscribe to our channel. See you next time, and stay safe.